So God's promise is to be a father. God has always been a father. He is a father in the promise he gave and in the covenant he made to Abraham. Look at Isaiah 63 verse 16. Doubtless thou art our father, though Abraham be ignorant of us, and Israel acknowledge us not. Thou, O Lord, art our father, our redeemer. Thy name is from everlasting. You are our father. Even though Israel and Moses don't know us, you are our father. This goes beyond Israel and the fatherhood of Abraham over them. This is talking about the father of nations. I'm teaching here. Hosea 11 verse 1. When Israel was a child, then I loved him and called my son out of Egypt. I called my son out of Egypt. All those phrases shows you that that is God's promise. That is God's will. He wanted to be a father to Israel. Deuteronomy 1:31. And in the wilderness where thou hast seen how that the Lord thy God bore thee, as a man doth bear his son, in all the way that you went until you came into this place. So the imagery of a father and a son. Look at Exodus 4:22. And thou shalt say unto Pharaoh, thus saith the Lord, Israel is my son, even my firstborn. God intends to do this by his spirit. So when you read Isaiah 52:54, for example, and God is called a husband. Isaiah 54 verse 5. God is a husband. Then Ezekiel chapter 16 verse 8 to 14. The description of God in the covenant is God is a husband. Even though he has an everlasting adulterous woman. Everlasting adulterous woman. He still remains her husband. Hosea demonstrated it. Married a wife. She went to prostitution. He went to the prostitution house. Married her again. She went again back to prostitution. This time around, she went into the kind of prostitution where to get her back, you have to pay. He went and paid and brought her back. In the prophecy of Hosea, demonstrating God's everlasting love for an adulterous wife, the church. That's why he's a husband. That's why the Bible uses those phrases for him. God couldn't keep his marriage with Israel. Because Israel was always departing. He will bring her back, she will depart. He will bring her back, she will depart. He never got tired of bringing her back. That's his nature. Jeremiah 31:32. Not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt. With my covenant they break. Although I was a husband unto them, saith the Lord. They broke the covenant even though I was their husband. The new covenant is also called a marriage. The new covenant is a marriage. You can read when you get home Ezekiel 16:59-60. Ezekiel 16:59-60. Hosea chapter 2 verse 7. Joel chapter 1 verse 8. Hosea 2:7. Joel 1:8. Isaiah 62 verse 5. Put it up for me. Isaiah 62 verse number 5. For as a young man marrieth a virgin, so shall thy sons marry thee. And as the bridegroom rejoiceth over the bride, so shall thy God rejoice over thee. So God therefore is a father. He is a husband in this new creation. All these things describe who he is and what he does. So in Exodus chapter 20, where we read the Ten Commandments, which is actually the word of God. Exodus 20 verse 5. Exodus chapter 20 verse 5. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve them. For I, the Lord thy God, a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve them. Now remember, Exodus 20 verse 1 to 11 is about faith and worship. Faith and worship of God. Exodus 20 verse 1 to 11. Believe in God. Have no other God beside him. Faith in God. So Exodus chapter 20 verse 1 to 7. Faith. Exodus chapter 20 verse 8 to 11. Rest. Sabaoth. Sabbath. And you know some people think when we say rest in Christ, it means cool down. Do nothing. Say rest in Christ. They just say okay. Cool down. Do nothing. No. To rest in him means operate from rest. Stay in rest and from rest function. So if we enter into his rest, He now begins to function through us. Rest was a language used for walk. What is the walk of God today? Honor. Just honor him. Thou shall not. Verse 13 to 17 of Exodus 20. Thou shall not, thou shall not. Why is he saying this? Because he is introducing a counterculture, a counter narrative, or a counter lifestyle. We don't go among to adapt. Mm-mm. We go against to take over. The church does not adapt. The church takes over because the church is counterculture. We don't do it so that we can be accepted. We do it because it's right. And in doing that, we change their minds. We don't get among them and try to be accepted by them. No, we get among them and establish who we are. And then who we are challenges their mind. And before you know it, they adapt to who we are. In Leviticus chapter 11 verse 44, put it up for me. Leviticus 11, 44. Glory to God. For I am the Lord your God. You shall therefore sanctify yourselves, and you shall be holy, for I am holy. Neither shall you defile yourselves with any manner of creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. Which means that in God's redemption, he doesn't covet. He honors, he loves. Let me mention the concept of love. Ahiv in the Hebrew. Love means to esteem the other person above yourself. Which was strange to humanity. To esteem the other person above yourself was very strange. It was counterculture. But that was God. To esteem. When you say you love, in God's language, you are esteeming the other person above yourself. Then God introduced it in the law of Moses. Why? Because God is changing how we think. God is changing how we think. In Leviticus 19:18, he says, to love your neighbor as yourself. It simply means to esteem the other person. Who are you supposed to love? Strangers, widows, no child sacrifice. These were the things Moses said within their world. You know, eye for eye, tooth for tooth, do me, I do you, scratch my back, I scratch yours, hit my leg, I hit yours, an eye for eye, you touch my leg, I touch your own 3 times. That was Moses' law. And God said, no, I changed the narrative. Love your neighbor as yourself. Love those who despitefully use you. Pray for those who persecute you. That's counterculture. That's not the lifestyle of the world. That's not how people live. If you live like that, people call you a fool. But that's God. Moses says it. Then Jesus said, no, but that's not the Heavenly Father. This is how the Heavenly Father functions. Do this that you may be the children of your Father who makes the sun to shine on the good and on the bad. Hello? Are you in the house? Our Heavenly Father is forgiving. Our Heavenly Father is redemptive. Our Heavenly Father rescues slaves and treats them well. When Jesus mentions the word Heavenly Father, he's referring to the founder of love. The founder of forgiveness. The one that initiated reconciliation as we see in Genesis. His father, because everything that is good started with him. Hallelujah. Everything that is good started with him. So when God is called father, he's not father in labor room. He's not father in the maternity ward. He is father in his promise of redemption. He is father in his promise of reconciliation. He is father in his forgiveness. So in what we call the Lord's Prayer, when Jesus says, our Father who art in heaven, your mind goes back to the promise of redemption, the promise of forgiveness, and the promise of the forgiveness of your sins, where he covers man's shame. Not just that, but we see him throughout the ages accommodate and tolerate in order to walk through and walk with God's word. That's why he's father. He tolerates, he accommodates, he covers because he is father. Am I teaching good? How many of you fathers here want to disgrace your children? When your children do wrong, you say, everybody gather, neighbors gather. This boy is a stupid boy. Can you imagine what happened? I sent him to go and buy something and bring change. He used the whole money. Very stupid boy. No parent does that. A father will cover. A father will protect. A father will forgive. A father will tolerate. That's why he's called father. God is called father because he tolerates. God is called father because he forgives. God is called father because he covers and protects. God is called father because he defends. That's why he's father. He forgives, he loves. That's why he's father. He has the capacity to take it in, absorb it, and forgive. That's why he's called father. It's not because he went to the labor ward to deliver children. Because of his love and mercy for the people he created, who have been adopted into his family by Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. So Jesus says, your kingdom come. And that's the kingdom we have been talking about. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven, which is what we are doing today, establishing his will all over the earth, bringing men into salvation, bringing men into the knowledge of God. So how is his will done on earth? His will is done on earth by his spirit, which we received in the new birth. So God is Father because he is the example. He is Father because he is the inaugurator. He is Father because he is the founder. He is the founder of all that he tells us to do. When he tells you to forgive, it's because he forgives. When he tells you to love, it's because he loves. When he tells you to tolerate, it's because he himself tolerates. God is Father because he is the example. Hallelujah. He can't ask you to do what he doesn't do.